Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching video casts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. Today in this episode, I am going to discuss about the diabetic foot ulcer. So after watching this video, all of you should be able to understand the overview and epidemiology, etiopathogenesis, clinical features, assessment, investigations, grading, and treatment of diabetic foot ulcer. So diabetic foot ulcer, the diabetes accounts for a substantial number of major foot infections. Every 20 seconds, your lower limb is amputated due to complication of diabetes. If infection is superficial, usually these patients will be having only ulceration or ulcer. If the infection is deep, usually this will affect the soft tissue only, or it can also involve bones as well as the joints. If it is bone involvement, patient will be having osteitis or osteomyelitis. If it is joint involvement, patient will be having pyogenic arthritis. Diabetic foot lesions are responsible for more hospitalization than any other complication of diabetes. Among patients with diabetes, 15% of these patients, they develop a foot ulcer. Among these foot ulcer, only 20 to 24% of these patients, they need or they require amputation eventually. So diabetic neuropathy tends to occur only 10 years after the onset of the diabetes, and therefore the diabetic foot deformity and ulceration both will occur only sometime thereafter. So it won't occur immediately after the patient developing diabetes. It will take minimum 10 years for the diabetic neuropathy to manifest, and then only these patients will develop both the ulceration in the foot and then the diabetic deformity. So it is preventable. They are at increased risk of infection, ulceration and trauma, which can lead to collapse of the foot, and this is also known as Charcot neuroarthropathy. So coming to the etiopathogenesis, the underlying causes of diabetic foot ulcers must be determined before deciding the treatment plan. In most patients, they'll be having peripheral neuropathy and or peripheral arterial disease, or some of them may have both peripheral neuropathy and peripheral arterial disease. This will play a central role. Diabetic foot ulcers are therefore commonly classified as neuropathic, those who are having peripheral neuropathy, or ischemic, those who are having peripheral arterial disease, or neuroischemic, where they are having both peripheral neuropathy as well as peripheral arterial disease. Coming to the peripheral neuropathy, this may predispose the foot for ulceration through its effects on three mechanisms: sensory, motor and autonomic nerves. So sensory neuropathy, usually loss of protective sensation, this render them vulnerable to physical, chemical and thermal trauma to the foot. Motor neuropathy can cause foot deformities such as hammertoes and claw foot. Autonomic neuropathy is typically associated with dry skin, which can result in fissures, cracking as well as calculus. The peripheral arterial disease will be the cause for the diabetic foot ulcer in 50% of these patients, and this is because of both macroangiopathy and microangiopathy. So coming to the clinical features of the diabetic foot ulcer, so I told you it is three types. One is neuropathic, another one is ischemic, and another one is neuroischemic. So here we are seeing the various clinical features. Regarding the sensation in neuropathic ulcer, there will be sensory loss. In ischemic, it is usually painful. In neuroischemic, there will be a degree of sensory loss. Regarding the callus and necrosis, in neuropathic ulcer, there will be callus present and often it is a very thick callus. Whereas in ischemic, usually there will be necrosis of the tissue. In neuroischemic, there will be minimal calculus and these ulcers are prone to go for necrosis also. So coming to the wound bed, in neuropathic ulcer, it will have pink and granulating surrounded by the callus. In ischemic ulcer, usually the wound bed will be pale and sloughy with poor granulation tissue. In neuroischemic also, in the wound bed, there will be poor granulation. Coming to the foot temperature and pulses, in neuropathic ulcer, usually the foot temperature, it is warm with bounding pulses. Whereas in ischemic ulcer, usually the foot is cool with absent pulses. In neuroischemic also, the foot will be cool with absent pulses. The other features, in neuropathic, it will be having dry skin and fissuring. Whereas in ischemic, the ulcer, the feature of delayed healing of the ulcer, in neuroischemic, high risk for infection. The typical location, neuropathic, is usually over the weight-bearing areas of the foot, such as metatarsal heads, the heel, and over the dorsum of clawed toes. In ischemic, the typical location is tip of the toes, nail edges, and between the toes and lateral borders of the foot. Whereas in neuroischemic, the characteristic site is margins of the foot and toes. In prevalence, the neuropathic ulcer is common in 35% of the diabetic patient, whereas ischemic is only in 15% of these diabetic foot ulcer patient. Neuroischemic is the cause, this is the commonest variety, it is comprising 50% of the diabetic foot ulcer. So here you are seeing three pictures. The first picture is neuropathic, you can see it, it is the ulcer is present over the plantar aspect of the foot, over the head of the metatarsal here. So here it is not over the plantar aspect, it is, you can see the typical location, tip of the toes, nail, or in between. This is the, this is over the, almost over the dorsum of the foot. This is because of ischemic, is our loss of blood supply. And here it is over the margin of the, margins of the foot or the toes. Typical, this is neuroischemic. So this is neuropathic, it is surrounded by callus, and this is characterized by the necrosis. This is ischemic ulcer, and this is neuroischemic ulcer. Coming to the assessment and investigation, first you have to take a thorough history and physicals. Patients with diabetic foot ulcer need to be assessed holistically to identify both the intrinsic and extrinsic factors. Full patient history, including medications, comorbidities, diabetes status, and symptoms suggestive of neuropathy or peripheral arterial disease, should be ascertained. Recording the size, this is physical examination, you have to record the size, depth, appearance, and location of diabetic foot ulcer. This will help in to establish the baseline for the treatment. Then you have to test for the loss of sensation. Two simple and effective tests for peripheral neuropathy are commonly used, that is 10G Semmes-Weinstein monofilament test, standard 128 Hex tuning fork test. The 10G monofilament is the most frequently used screening tool. A positive result is inability to feel the monofilament when it is pressed against three places in the plantar foot with enough force to bend the filament. Neuropathy is also demonstrated by an inability to sense vibration from a standard tuning fork. So this is how to test the loss of sensation. So this is the procedure. This is, this here you can see, this is the foot. These are the three areas, these blue areas, these are the three areas you have to test. This is the monofilament, you have to touch that area and give enough pressure so that this monofilament will bend. So this is how you have to do it. Three areas you can test, and then the area denoted by the violet is the fourth area. The other dots are other areas also you can you can try, and you can do it on both the foot. You can do this test. So I request my viewers to pause the video, and this is the tabular column informing you how to do this test thoroughly. So you have to pass the video and then you read all these things to get the whole information. So the another thing you have to do is you have to test for macroangiopathy or testing for the peripheral vascular disease. First thing is testing for macroangiopathy. This is assessment of peripheral pulses clinically. You can try to feel the pulses, or the gold standard is, of course, you have to do the duplex scan or the Doppler ultrasound. You can also do ankle brachial pressure index. This is another way of bedside investigation to clinch the diagnosis of peripheral arterial disease. You can also do toe pressure and transcutaneous oxygen measurement. These are useful for measuring local tissue perfusion. You can know by doing these tests. A patient with acute limb ischemia characterized by the six P's, that is pulselessness, pain, pallor, piercing cold, that is poikilothermia, paresthesia and paralysis, poses a clinical emergency and may be at great risk if not managed in a timely and effective manner. For testing the microangiopathy, you can do a test called infrared dermal thermography. This is a technique for assessing the risk of developing diabetic foot ulcer. Actually, we are testing the temperature in the plantar skin. So asymmetries in plantar skin temperature between both the feet, that you can ascertain. Left foot had low skin temperature. You can see this red is the maximum normal temperature. So slowly it is yellow and then green and then blue, and then the blue is the worst thing. That is, the temperature is very low. So this is light blue and then the yellow, green, and then if it is a normal temperature, this will be denoted by the red color. So easily we can compare the areas in the same side foot, or you can compare both the feet also. So you will be, if the temperature is very low, so these patients are having, if not macroangiopathy, at least they are having microangiopathy. So this temperature, difference is a very good indication for showing the risk for developing the diabetic foot ulcer in future. So this test is very, but it is a computer generated test. So coming to the testing for infection, 56% of diabetic foot ulcers become infected, and 20% of these patients with an infected foot wound will undergo a lower extremity amputation. Patient may not present with classical signs of infection and inflammation because many of these patients are immunocompromised. Extensive inflammation, crepitus, bullae, necrosis of gangrene are signs of very severe foot infection. You have to also look for bony involvement like osteomyelitis. So osteomyelitis is a deep infection, whereas ulceration is a superficial infection. So these infection can be graded to grade 1 to grade 4. If it is grade 1, means uninfected or no clinical signs of infection. Grade 2 means mild infection, superficial tissue lesion with at least 2 of the following signs: local warmth, erythema of more than 0.5 to 2 cm around the ulcer, local tenderness and pain, local swelling, induration and purulent discharge. Other causes of inflammation of the skin must be excluded. So if it is grade 3, this is moderate, erythema is more than 2 cm and one of the findings below, above or the below things. The infection involving structures beneath the skin, that is the subcutaneous tissue like deep abscess, lymphangitis, osteomyelitis, septic arthritis or fasciitis. No systemic inflammatory response or SIRS. Grade 4 is severe infection, presence of systemic signs with at least two of the following. Temperature is more than 39 degrees Celsius or less than 36 degrees Celsius. Pulse is more than 90 beat per minute. Respiratory rate is more than 20 per minute. PaCO2 is less than 32 millimeter of mercury. White cell count is more than 12,000 or less than 4,000. 10% immature leukocytes also will be there in in differential count. So for testing foot deformity, the typical presentations resulting from high plantar pressure areas in patients with motor neuropathy are the foot may be having high arch foot, hammer toes or clawed foot, visible muscle wasting on the dorsum between the metatarsal bones, gait changes such as foot slapping on the ground, hallux valgus, hallux rigidus and fatty pad depletion. Charcot joint is a form of neuroarthropathy. This is also give an appearance of flat foot or rock bottom appearance. This is what you are seeing. This is a flat foot or rock bottom appearance. So these are the areas where these are the plantar pressure areas over the bony prominence, head of the metatarsal. This is the heel, this is the arch of the foot. And patient will be having hammer toe. This is what you are seeing here is hammer toe with clawed foot. This also will be there. And patient eventually will go for neuroarthropathy, Charcot's neuroarthropathy. This is called Charcot's neuroarthropathy with flat foot that will give an appearance of rock bottom appearance. So this is three clinical pictures you are seeing. The first picture, Charcot foot with just plantar ulcer only. Here you are seeing, apart from the ulcer, you are seeing an abscess also. This is deep-seated abscess you are seeing. Eventually the whole joint also will get infected, the bone also will get infected. The patient will go for what is called chronic Charcot foot or Charcot neuroarthropathy, giving a rock bottom appearance of flat foot. This is what you are seeing here in this picture. So coming to the grading of diabetic foot ulcer, this is called Wagner-Meggitt classification. There are from grade 0 to grade 5. Grade 0, foot symptoms, only symptoms like pain is there. There is no ulcer in grade 0. In grade 1, superficial ulcers are present. Grade 3, deep ulcers. Grade 2, deep ulcers. Grade 3, ulcer with bone involvement. Grade 4, forefoot gangrene. Grade 5, the whole foot gangrene. The same thing you are seeing it in diagrammatic representation here. See, in grade 0, only pain, there is no evidence of any ulcer. In grade 1, there is superficial ulcer. Deep ulcer in grade 2. And in grade 3, there is deep ulcer, or this is also having bony involvement or osteomyelitis here. So here it is a gangrene of the forefoot, that is grade 4. Grade 5 is the gangrene of the whole foot. So this is the classification all of you should know. This is Wagner-Meggitt classification of diabetic foot ulcer. So coming to the management, the essential components of management are, you have to treat the underlying disease processes. You have to ensure adequate blood supply to the foot. And then local wound care, including infection control. And then the pressure offloading. So these are the four main components of management for diabetic foot ulcer. So treating the underlying disease process, all patients with critical limb ischemia should be referred for consideration of arterial reconstruction. Another important thing is you have to achieve optimal diabetic control. This involves achieving tight glycemic control and managing the risk factors such as high blood pressure, hyperlipidemia, and smoking. You have to address the physical causes of the trauma, like you have to examine the patient's footwear for proper fit, wear and tear, and the presence of any foreign bodies that may traumatize the foot. Coming to ensuring the adequate blood supply, the patient with acute limb ischemia is a clinical emergency and may be at great risk if not managed in a timely and effective way. Aside from critical limb ischemia, decreased perfusion or impaired circulation may be an indicator for revascularization to achieve and maintain healing and to avoid or delay a future amputation. Coming to local wound care, including infection control, you have to optimize local wound care. There is a thing called time framework for managing the diabetic foot ulcer. These are tissue debridement. Time is the mnemonic. T is tissue debridement. I is inflammation and infection control. M is moisture balance, including optimal dressing selection. And E is epithelial edge advancement. So what is tissue debridement? This includes surgical or sharp debridement. Debridement means removing all the dead tissue surgically, or you have to cut and remove all the dead tissue. This can be done by using larvae like maggots you can use, or autolytic method, and more recently they are using hydrosurgery and even ultrasonic method to do tissue debridement. The requirement for further debridement should be determined at each dressing change. You have to examine the ulcer and you have to decide whether the ulcer needs debridement or not. Here you are seeing a neuropathic ulcer with lot of disease over the plantar aspect of the foot, over the first metatarsal head. So patient is having a deep punched out ulcer here and with a surrounding callus. This is before the debridement. After debridement, so you have to remove the callus as well as any slough inside or the dead soft tissue. Everything you have to do, you have to remove, and that is what is called wound debridement. That you have to do surgically. So coming to the infection control, inflammation and infection control, early and aggressive treatment in presence of even subtle signs of infection should be instituted. You have to send wound swab for culture and sensitivity, and you have to select appropriate antibiotics. Topical antibacterial you can use for superficial infections, while for deep infection you should use IV broad spectrum antibiotics. So these are the general principles for management, for bacterial management. I request all my viewers to pause the video and read all these things so that you will get a view of how to select and how to do the infection control. So coming to the moisture balance or optimal dressing selection, most of the dressings are designed to create a moist wound environment and support progression towards wound healing. Many practitioners are confused by the great range of dressing available. So guidelines for dressing selection is here in this tabular column, and I again request my viewers to pause the video and go through this the tabular column to gain a thorough knowledge of how to select the proper wound dressing in diabetic foot ulcer. So coming to the epithelial edge advancement, so you have to debride the edges of the ulcer to remove potential physical barriers to growth of epithelium across the ulcer bed. This is what is called epithelial edge advancement. If wound does not respond to standard wound management intervention, adjunctive therapies may be considered. The adjunctive treatments such as negative pressure wound therapy or vacuum assisted closure or NPWT, that is negative pressure wound therapy, biological dressings, bioengineered skin equivalents, hyperbaric oxygen therapy, platelet rich plasma and growth factors, all these things new or latest advance in the treatment for diabetic foot ulcers. And another important thing is the pressure offloading. In patients with peripheral neuropathy, it is important to offload at-risk areas of the foot in order to redistribute pressures evenly. This is what is called pressure offloading. The gold standard is the total contact cost or TCC, which distributes pressure evenly over the entire plantar surface of the foot. TCC or total contact cast are contraindicated in patients with ischemia because of the risk of inducing further diabetic foot ulcers. They are not appropriate for patients with infected diabetic foot ulcers or osteomyelitis because you cannot inspect the wound daily. In these patients, you can use removable casts like walkers, scotch cast boots, healing sandals and crutches, walkers and wheelchairs. These are other removable, pressure offloading devices. So this is another tabular column where you can, what are the alternative to the total contact cast? These are the removable cast walkers, scotch cast boots, healing sandals, crutches, walkers and wheelchairs. I told all these things. So in many countries, some of these items are not available, but I request my viewers once again to pause the video and read this tabular column to gain a thorough knowledge about the other alternatives to total contact casts. So coming to amputation and post-amputation care. Suppose if patient develops already a gangrene like this, usually it will develop in one of the toes and then it will spread to the dorsum of the foot and proximally. So earlier is better. If you are seeing a toe like this with gangrene, you have to do amputation immediately. It should not be considered unless a detailed vascular assessment has been performed by a vascular staff. Indication for amputation are ischemic wrist pain that cannot be managed by analgesia or revascularization. A life-threatening foot infection that cannot be managed by other methods. Non-healing ulcer that is accompanied by a high burden of disease then would result from amputation. Special arrangements should be made for people with disabilities and immobilities. So if patient is having a toe gangrene like this, you have to go for what is called ray amputation. If it is spreading over the dorsum of the foot or even involving the ankle and part of the lower part of the leg, then you have to go for below knee amputation. So that is what you have to do. But once the patient has gone for gangrene, you cannot resurrect the dead tissue. So you have to do eventually only amputation. That is the thing you have to do. But before doing amputation, a thorough vascular evaluation should be done. The amputation is the last resort. You should not do amputation just like that. You have to get a vascular opinion and then only you have to decide whether to do amputation or not. So this is a global wound care plan. This is very important for diabetic foot ulcer treatment. So the it comprises of A, B, C, D and four things only. So number one is you have to diagnose diabetes with or without peripheral sensory neuropathy. The aim is you have to prevent the development of diabetic foot ulcer, because diabetic foot ulcer is totally preventable. So you have to pick up this diabetic foot ulcer early, and you have to do aggressively. You have to treat this diabetic foot ulcer. You have to prevent the progression of this diabetic foot ulcer. Development of DFU. The aim is treatment of the ulcer and the prevention of infection. So this also I request my viewers to pause the video and read all these details. So I am going to, talk only the heading. That is A, B is treat the ulcer and prevent the infection. C is you have to prevent the complication associated with the ischemia. So you have to treat the ischemia. And then D is prevent life or limb threatening complications. How to prevent this, all these things, you can pause the video and you can read all these details. So active management of the ulcer and comorbidities should aim to prevent amputation. So eventually you have to try to prevent the amputation. So this I will be discussing in a subsequent slide. So take home messages. Totally, this diabetic foot ulcer is totally preventable. So it is, the old adage is prevention is better than cure. So you have to give proper patient education so that they will follow the treatment and you can avoid the progression of the ulcer into gangrene, and then the subsequent amputation you can prevent. So you can also do good glycemic control, regular foot assessment including vascular and neurological assessment, and to prevent the diabetic foot ulcer. The main underlying cause of diabetic foot ulcer is chronic pressure, so you have to use the offloading techniques properly. The diabetic foot ulcer need multidisciplinary approach, a multidisciplinary foot care team or MDFT team should take care all the diabetic foot ulcer treatment. So thank you very much. So sorry, I have to, this is the four essential things for prevention of diabetic foot ulcer. You have to educate the patient properly. You have to take care of the skin and toenail care. You have to use protective foot gear, and sometimes you can use protective surgeries like thorough wound debridement. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that all these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share this video in your social media. Thank you once again for watching this video. Let us meet in another video. Until then, bye-bye.